This sermon is titled Book Study, Acts chapters 9 and 10. Be enriched as you listen.
Welcome to the book of Acts, chapters 9 and 10. So that's the episode that we are on. I hope all of you, all of us have been really enjoying this journey through the book of Acts. Amen. Like it's been like every week, we're just looking forward to that next episode. What will it bring? What's going to happen? It's so exciting. Right, and as we go through, we see that it's about us. It's about people who accepted the Lord, people who got born again, people who were filled with the Spirit and journeying with the Lord. It's really actually about us, right? And how we can be and how we can live and how we can journey with the Lord. And it's a template of for the contemporary church. How and what we can base our church on, and what we can do as God's people. Right. So today also we're going to continue on our journey. And but before that, I just want to say that Pastor Ashish is in Mangalore today, and he's ministering over there. There's also a baby dedication that's happening even as we speak right now. Pastor John Paul's daughter is getting dedicated. So yeah, so Pastor's there, and he'll be back next Sunday. Okay, so how many of you have been tracking, enjoying the journey, Book of Acts? Okay, and any homework done? Have you been reading at home, reading up? Okay, so that would really be helpful because we're not really going verse by verse, right? It'll really help if we read at home and then come and then we can track easily. For those of you who just joined us online just for today and all the first-time visitors, you know, we've been studying the book of Acts and we've been journeying from, you know, chapter 1 onwards. And the sermons are there online on our website, and the sermon notes are there, even the PowerPoint presentations are there. So you can feel free to, you know, download it and use it and get up to speed on, you know, what we've been journeying through as a church. Okay, so we see, we looked at chapter 8 last Sunday, and we see that we read about the revival at Samaria and how Philip was there. God used him mightily, and how he met with the Ethiopian official, you know, really awesome, God-appointed, God-orchestrated moment. He was obedient. And then he comes out of the water after baptizing the Ethiopian official, and we see supernatural transportation. Right? He is taken up and he's transported to a place called Azotus, about 75 kilometers from that place. Something amazing, but the Bible just states it as if, yeah, this is what God does. Right? So supernatural transportation, we need it in Bangalore, you know, rush hour. But praise God, you know, he does it in amazing ways when we really need it. And Philip was found there and he continued on his journey. And we read about his daughters who prophesied and so on. So Philip is known as a Philip the evangelist. Wherever he went, he could not help but share the gospel. You know, times were difficult, he shared the gospel. Times were okay, he shared the gospel. Great revival happening, he continued to minister, right? So, chapter 9, we see Saul being introduced again. You know, if you recall, we see that Saul is mentioned at the end of chapter 7, where it says that there was this young man who was looking after the garments and consenting to the death of Stephen, the first martyr of the church. And so he was there, and then we see him introduced there. And also chapter 8, where we see Saul persecuting the church. He went everywhere persecuting the church. So in chapter 9, we see Saul on a mission. So what is interesting is Saul was always a missionary. We think that he, you know, he came to know Christ and then he became a missionary. No, he was always a missionary. He was always on a mission. But his mission before coming to know the Lord was mission persecution. And he did it so well. Right? He did it intentionally. He did it with a plan. He took letters of permission from the high priest. And he went and he traveled. And the letters actually basically gave him the license to arrest people who were called disciples of Jesus. Or people who were following the way. That was how they were referred to. Disciples of Jesus and the way, people who follow the way. And then he would bring them So he went with that intention of capturing them and bringing them bound to Jerusalem. So he created havoc in the church. There was so much of confusion among the believers because of Paul. So he's journeying. He's going to Damascus and he's on this mission. But on this mission and on the way to Damascus, he has this encounter. The Bible says there's a great light shone around him. It was so bright that he fell off his horse or donkey, or whatever he was traveling on. He fell off and he couldn't see. It was so bright. And there not only a light, great light, but there was a voice from heaven saying, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" So something happened to Saul the minute he fell off. The time between he fell off the animal and hit the ground, something happened to him in his heart. Because he gets up and he asks, "Who are you, Lord?" He realizes something, this is something way beyond whatever he has seen or heard or experienced. This is something supernatural and this is, you know, this is beyond him. So in his heart, he realizes that, hey, I need to humble myself. I need to address this person as Lord. And he says, "Who are you, Lord?" And the Lord says, "I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. And it is difficult for you to kick against the goads or these sharp spikes. Why are you doing that?" And then he says, "Lord, what must I do?" Total transformation. "Who are you, Lord? What do you want me to do?" And the Lord gives him instruction. He says, "Okay, you go to this place. You go to this house. And you be there. And there will come a time and then you will be told what you need to do." Now, at the same time, the Bible says that there was a disciple who was there in Damascus. At the same time, this disciple is having a vision. His name is Ananias. You know, just look at the beauty of the whole thing and how God orchestrates, you know, times and people and places. And, you know, we learned about the Chronos and the Kairos of God. And this is a Kairos moment. And God is speaking to Ananias in a vision. And he hears this, you know, "Ananias, you go." And he's giving him specific instructions, right? "You go to the street." He's literally giving him the location, the address. Say, "Go to the street. It is called Straight. And go to this house, the house of Judas." And then he says, "You inquire for Saul of Tarsus." And he's praying right now. And not only that, but he's praying and he is having a vision. And in his vision, he's seeing you come and lay hands on him and pray for him. So Ananias, go. Now, a couple of things to be noted here. God sends a disciple, a follower of the Lord, on this very important mission of praying over Saul, who is going to be, you know, writing 2/3 of the New Testament, who's going to be planting many churches. And it's amazing to see that God would send someone who's a follower, who's obedient to him, right? He doesn't look for tags or titles or designations, but he sends a disciple to go and do this all-important thing. And also we see that, yes, it's a big call, probably bigger than the call that Ananias has, right? We don't read about Ananias ever again. But only this mission, it was a big mission. He had to go do it. And he did it in fear and trembling. But if you see, you know, he asked, "Oh God, you know, I've heard about this man. I know the kind of man he is. And I've heard about him. He's persecuting your people." And the Lord says, "Go. He's a chosen vessel. And I'm going to show him the things that he must go through and suffer for my name's sake. He's going to be a witness before Gentiles and kings. So you go, Ananias." So we see that, well, the Lord can actually use us to pray over people, to declare God's call over people, you know, release a prophetic word over people. And this call could be much bigger than us. So we might wonder and, you know, kind of shrink inside saying, "Hey, I'm only doing this. You know, I'm a homemaker and, you know, I'm working 9 to 5 and I, you know, who am I to go and declare over this person that, hey, God's got a big plan, big call, and you're going to be used in this mighty way. Who am I?" Right? But that's God. He uses willing hearts and he uses the simple, ordinary people because he's an extraordinary God and he will do extraordinary things in and through us. Amen. Amen. So Ananias goes and he prays over Saul, and something happens. You know, before that, we see that, you know, all these places that we see, Ananias' house, I think that picture that we just saw, Ananias' house, and also the street, all these are real places, right? In modern day Syria, it's all there. So we're not talking about something which is fictitious or people who are, you know, some people's own imaginations and making, but these are real people, real places, and real incidents that we're talking about, right? And so the Lord still speaks to us in visions. That's another thing that we see. Well, God speaks to us through his word, and God leads us by his spirit. He quickens the word to us through his spirit. And that's the primary way he speaks. But there are other avenues by which he speaks. And God gives visions. God gives dreams. And there are other supernatural ways, angelic visitations and sovereign visitations by which he leads and he speaks to us. Amen. So we can say, Lord, I open my heart. I open my life. You speak to me. You get me, God, whatever way. Right? I don't want to shut down these avenues and say, God, only this way. No. God, I open my life. You speak. You speak. I just want to hear you and be led by you. So God speaks in these amazing ways. So anyway, so Ananias goes and he refers to Saul. He calls and he says, Brother Saul. So by this time, Saul has become a brother in the Lord to Ananias. And Ananias obviously is also convinced about the vision that he has had, Saul has had. And so he goes and addresses him as Brother Saul. And he declares over them three things, right? He says, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the road as you came has sent me that you might receive your sight. So that's the first thing. He lays hands, prays. Saul receives his sight. Something like scales fall off his eyes and he's able to see again after 3 days. And then he says that you might be filled with the Holy Spirit. And so the Bible also says that he was baptized. And later on in Acts 22, I think, where Paul is recounting his testimony, actually. So he talks about how he was baptized in the Spirit and how he took water baptism and all that. So we see that, well, Paul was born again. He received his sight. He was filled with the Spirit. And yes, we know that he also prayed in tongues because to the Corinthian church, much later, he writes in 1 Corinthians 14, you know, I speak in tongues, I pray in tongues more than you all. And he, in fact, lays down doctrine about the gifts of the Spirit and the usage of the Spirit and the right way in the church and so on. So we know that he also received the Holy Spirit with, you know, these manifestations of praying in tongues and so on. And so he immediately starts preaching. Right? Now, these 3 days, I'm sure something would have happened to Saul. You know, he's sitting there, nowhere to go, and something is happening in his heart. This encounter with Jesus is fresh. It's fresh in his memory. He cannot shake it out. But also, in his mind, you know, he's a Pharisee. You know, I believe all Jewish males have to commit to memory or study the first 5 books of the Old Testament, the Torah. They have to learn it by heart, every Jewish male. And a Pharisee has to learn the whole Old Testament, the Psalms and the prophets and everything by heart. So Saul is someone who knows it by heart. In fact, the Lord Jesus himself, you know, he quotes all these Old Testament scriptures, right, in his teachings, and it comes from his heart, from his memory. So Saul is thinking about all this. Hey, you know, this is what was prophesied about the Messiah. And everything is making sense now, right? He's connecting the dots. And for the first time in his life, things are making sense. All his learning and training. And the Bible says that he was trained again under Gamaliel, the one who was there, you know, in the Sanhedrin. So he was trained under the very best. And everything is making sense. I'm sure he would have thought of Stephen's message also. Stephen, you know, he was there I'm sure he heard Stephen, and he heard about Stephen says, you know, I see the heavens open, I see the Father, I see the Son standing next to him, and he's filled with the Holy Spirit, and his face is glowing with a heavenly glow, and he's recalling all that. And I'm sure he's also thinking about Peter and John, who were there at the temple, and he was there with the council, and Saul was also there. And, you know, he was part of the Sanhedrin, and Peter and John declaring boldly about Jesus. So all this is going on in his mind, and by the time Ananias comes and he prays over him, he receives his sight, he's filled with the Holy Spirit, he's praying in tongues, and that's it, he's ready. He's ready. He cannot but preach the gospel. So he goes to the synagogues in Damascus and he's preaching the gospel. He's saying, hey, Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the Son of God. And I'm sure they had questions. They had, you know, arguments and debates. But no one could refute, because the Bible says that he confounded the Jews with his wisdom, the knowledge, and the experience. He's speaking from that. And no one could resist him. So this went on for some time. He's preaching. He's and in all these areas. And now we see that the persecuted Saul has become the preacher. Right? He's preaching. He continues to preach. But the Jews there, they wouldn't have any of it. So they decided, they plotted to do away with Saul. Say, we need to, you know, we need to bring this to an end. So he also becomes the persecuted. The persecuted one becomes, the persecutor becomes the persecuted. Right? So we see that. And we see that the Bible says that he was led down through the wall in a large basket because there was an attempt on his life. But what is interesting is, you know, this is mentioned in Acts chapter 9 and verse 25. Verse 26 says that Saul came to Jerusalem. But what is interesting is that when we read about Paul's testimony in Galatians 1, and we're just going into a little bit of history and testimony and geography and history and so on. So what is interesting is that some 3 years have passed, right? That those two verses actually span 3 years of duration. Because Paul says in Galatians 1, he says that after he accepted the Lord, after this God revealed his Jesus in me, that he might preach to the Gentiles. This is Galatians 1 and verse 17. He says, I did not go to Jerusalem to those who were apostles, but I went to Arabia and returned again to Damascus. Then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem. So he was in the region called Arabia, which the Bible scholars say that it could be the kingdom of Nabatea, which was ruled by King Aretas, because even about Aretas, Paul makes a reference. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, he makes a reference that at that time when he escaped from Damascus, there was this King Aretas who ruled over, and the governor who was there at Damascus actually reported to Aretas. Right. So we understand this, that he goes to, he was preaching in Arabia, he was preaching in this region called Nabatea, which is located in modern-day Jordan, and then he was preaching. Now, after 3 years, after this encounter, Saul goes up to Jerusalem, and Barnabas facilitates that, introduces him to the disciples. He spends time with Peter. He spends time with James. But all the other disciples are still apprehensive. Right? So his fame, his reputation was so strong that they did not believe. They said, oh, this could be an insider. This could be, you know, maybe some scheme by the Jewish officials to find out and to persecute. So they didn't want anything to do with it. Right? But Barnabas, being the encourager, the son of encouragement, right? I guess he just threw caution to the wind, or maybe he was just simple. He said, then I believe. But he took Saul and introduced him to the disciples. Now, for the next 10 or 14 years, he was there in this region, Cilicia and Syria. And we see that we don't really know much about his ministry, right? The Bible says that he was unknown by face in that region, he himself says in Galatians 1. And they were only hearing this testimony. He who was formerly persecuting is now preaching. So that is what they heard. So he was in that region and he was he stayed there. And again, Barnabas reaches out to him in Antioch and then reaches out to him in Tarsus, takes him to Antioch. And after a year, you know, they go to Jerusalem and so on. So we see that he has had an unmistakable supernatural encounter. We also know that, you know, he has spent this time just preaching. Everything makes sense. And what he's preaching and sharing is from the scripture. And no one could actually stand and refute his wisdom. But this passage of time, this chronos of 14 years. Right? So sometimes we think, you know, God, I'm ready. I'm ready, God. I have the call. And I know I've received those prophetic words and so on. And send me, Lord. I'm ready. But we see that God has a sense of timing. There is a preparation before the commissioning. There is a training before the release, right, into the fullness of the call. So whatever it was in that passage of time, it was building Saul, building Paul on the inside. Right? There was strength being built up. Probably he was facing all these persecutions and trials and challenges, and faith was being built up in him. And yes, certain things probably were weeded out, taken out of his life. And certain things were established in him and made strong. So if anyone here is going through that season, maybe you're watching online and saying, and you're thinking, you know, God, when? Well, God has a sense of timing. But if we would posture our heart to be faithful to what God has entrusted to us today, and be faithful and obedient to the witness. Hey, this is to the testimony. This is what I saw. This is what I experienced. And this is what I know. And continue on with God. Well, Lord's plan is to release us into the fullness of the call that he has for us. Just like he did with Saul. Amen. So, I know Bible college students are here and, you know, maybe working professionals and, you know, you have the call of God. There's something burning inside of you. Every morning you get up and you're like, I need to be somewhere else. But just check whether it's of the flesh or of the spirit, you know. Sometimes because of the difficulty, you know, it was like that for me. When I was working, I was just working for the weekend. I said, God, I don't know. Every time people ask, where do you see yourself 5 years from now? God, I don't see where tomorrow is. And so I'm like, God, it's so difficult. But God had to establish certain things in me, right? And God had to put certain things in me, in my life. God had to remove certain things which I thought were, hey, it's okay. Everyone has these weaknesses. But no, God had to put it out, take it out, so that the pressures or the work of ministry or trials and challenges will not, you know, will not destroy. And our testimony will continue to be strong, right? So even as we are patient and as we journey with God, God has a plan, God has a purpose, and God will release us into the fullness. So during this time, we see that he was in Tarsus, he's preaching in all these districts of Judea and Samaria and Galilee. The Bible declares that the churches throughout this region, wherever he persecuted, Judea, Galilee, and Samaria, it had peace, right? The churches had peace. The people gathering together, they had peace. It also says that, we're looking at, verse 31, chapter 9, verse 31. It says, this region had peace. They were edified, which means they were spiritually growing and strengthened. And it also says that they were walking in the fear of the Lord, reverent fear of God, fear of the Lord, and in the comfort or strength of the Holy Spirit. And even as we were doing so, these churches, these gatherings were multiplied. Right? People were coming to the Lord. People were experiencing salvation. And they were in turn going and sharing. And so it was great peace and great multiplication happening in all these places of worship. Then we read about Peter goes to all these regions again, right? He starts going. Now the persecution of Saul has stopped, and Peter travels. He goes on an itinerant trip, and he's preaching in all these different regions. He goes to this place called Lydda, and the Bible says that as he passed through, Peter passed through all parts of the country, he also came to the saints who dwelt at Lydda. And he came to that place, and he finds this man, a certain man named Aeneas. Now, this person had been bedridden for 8 long years. He was paralyzed, bedridden for 8 long years. So therefore, you know, we know that he was in a desperate situation. And we know, you know, if we are in bed for 1 day or 2 days, you know, we just want to get back and continue to do those things that we have, you know, we just long to get back to normalcy. And he's been in bed for 8 years. He goes, meets him, and he says, "Aeneas, Jesus the Christ heals you. Arise and make your bed." You know, if you see, there's a lot of parallel between the way the Lord ministered and the way Peter ministers. "Arise, take up your bed and walk." The words of the Lord. Peter does the same thing. "Aeneas, Jesus the Christ heals you. Arise and make your bed." So Aeneas gets up, and the Bible says that all those who dwelt or stayed in that region, Lydda and Sharon, they came to know the Lord. They came to know the Lord. So this sign was like a big billboard, was like a big sign which said, "Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus heals." Right? He's bigger than all limitations. Limitations put on by physical limitations or disease or sickness. Jesus is bigger. Then he goes on to, even as he's there in Lydda, in a neighboring town called, south of Lydda, called Joppa, which is a seaside town, there was this disciple named Tabitha, also known as Dorcas, and she's a good woman, she's a lot of good works, and, you know, she stitches a lot of things for people, but she falls sick and she dies. So people send for Peter, saying, "Please ask him to come." And her body is washed and kept in an upper room, and Peter comes there, and everybody's, you know, mourning. There are widows who are mourning and showing Peter, you know, "See, this is what Dorcas did for us. This is what Dorcas stitched for us. Well, she was a good woman." And Peter puts them all out of the room. And that also seems like a parallel to what the Lord Jesus did. You know, if you recall, Jesus went to Jairus' house, and he does the same thing. He goes there, and everybody's wailing and mourning and so on. And he says, you know, the child is asleep. And then he puts everybody outside except Peter and a couple of other disciples who go with him. And he does the same thing. He puts them all out. He goes in. And the Lord Jesus, he says, you know, "Talitha, little girl, I say to you, arise." Peter prays, and he does the same thing. He says, "Tabitha, arise." And she opened her eyes. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. So she opened her eyes, and obviously she saw Peter staring at her, and she was startled, and she stood up, sat up, and Peter raised her by the hand. Amen. The early church, right? The kind of anointing they walked in, and even before we desire that same kind of anointing, the kind of sold out lives that they had. Right? They completely sold out, totally sold out, saying, "Jesus, no matter what." Probably that was the t-shirt. "Jesus, no matter what," that was what they wore. Right? And because of this wonder or sign, the region throughout Joppa says that many believed on the Lord, and he stayed for many days in Joppa in the house of this person called Simon. He was another Simon. So Simon Peter stays in the house of Simon the tanner. Right, so he was Simon the Tanner is tanning or working with the hides of animals. That's his profession, and so Peter stays there. Now, as he was there, the Bible talks about, we're in chapter 10 now. So the Bible talks about this Roman centurion called Cornelius. Right? Now, this Roman centurion was a devout man. It says he worshipped Yahweh. Now, we don't know how and all that happened, but he was a good man. He helped the poor. He gave alms and he prayed the Jewish way. And one day, as he's praying, he has this angelic visitation, right? Roman centurion, adopted Jewish way of worship, and he's in prayer, a good man, generous man, and he has this angelic visitation. And the Lord speaks to Cornelius, and again, some very specific instructions. You know, it's amazing that the Lord can give that. Obviously, he knows everything. He knows everyone. He knows every place. But that he would choose to speak to us and give us direction with such specific detail. So he says, the angel of the Lord speaks to Cornelius and says, you send men to this place called Joppa. Now, Cornelius is in this region called Caesarea, again, north. And then he says, send men to Joppa. Okay. Ask for a man called Simon, whose surname is Peter. You know, suppose they bring the wrong Simon. You know, Simon the Tanner. And Simon is like, hey, I don't have anything for you guys. Right? Send for the man, Simon Peter, full name. And then he says, whose house is by the sea. You know, directions. So they go, and Cornelius immediately sends two of his servants, trusted people, and sends a soldier, and they set out to Joppa. At the same time, you know, we see this pattern. Philip goes, the Ethiopian official is traveling. We see here he's there, and the Roman centurion sends the people, and the Lord is doing something there. Ananias is sent. At the same time, the Lord is doing something in Saul's life, right? The timing of God, the kairos of God. And he's doing something here for Peter. Peter is just getting ready for lunch, right? He's there and he's praying. He's getting ready for lunch. The Bible says that he falls into a trance and he has a vision. And in the vision, he sees something that he's kind of familiar with, but it's actually disgusting for him. Right? He sees a big sheet coming from heaven. All the animals are there. Talks about wild animals and crawly, creepy things and birds of the air. Everything is there. And hears a voice. Peter, rise and kill and eat. This happens three times. And every time this voice, rise, kill and eat. And Peter says, I cannot do this. I cannot do this because these are unclean animals. And I can't. You know, being a Jewish person, you know, there are certain things that are ritually impure or profane. So I can't. But the voice is, whom God has cleansed, you cannot call common or ritually profane. Whom God has cleansed. So he's thinking, okay, I have this vision. I don't have an understanding now. What, do I change my diet or what? You know, is it something to do with lunch? But even as he's thinking about this, he hears that people are at the gate. You know, the people have come and they're at the gate. They're inquiring about Simon Peter. And then he goes and says, yes, I am he. I'm the one that you're looking for. And then these people stay there for the evening and the night. And then the next day, Peter goes with them. So by then, the Holy Spirit tells him, even as he's waiting, you know, there are these men, three men at the gate. You go with them doubting nothing. You go with them doubting nothing. You know, our God is a God who speaks. Our God is a God who speaks. Our God is a God who leads. Our God is a God who guides. Our God is a God who is so strategic. Amen. And we just need to learn to listen to him and hear his voice and be obedient. So he speaks and he says, this is what you must do. And so they set out and they go to Cornelius's house. So they reach there and Cornelius is excited. He's already made preparations. He's called his friends. He's called his relatives. And you can imagine the scene as they go into the living room. Everybody's there. And Cornelius, he sees Peter walk in and he goes and falls on his feet and he starts worshiping. It's like, I need to worship someone. God has called me, God said, God spoke, and here you are. And he just falls at his feet and starts worshiping. And Peter says, hey, I'm a person like you. I'm a human being like you. So, you know, don't. And then he goes to Cornelius, and they're having this conversation. I think they're just walking in. And he says, you know, Cornelius, you know, it's not good. In fact, it's ritually unlawful for a Jewish person to have fellowship with a non-Jewish person or a Gentile to have fellowship. You know, it's not lawful, right? But God spoke to me, whom he has cleansed. You know, it's all making sense now. Even as he's having this conversation, Peter, the impulsive one, he starts having this conversation. It's all making sense. The vision that he had, the voice that he heard. And so he's saying, you know what, Cornelius? God said, has shown me that I should not call any man common or unclean. He's made the connection. The lights have come on. He said, I should not call any man common or unclean. I know that it's ritually unlawful. I can't explain it, but God has spoken. And so he goes in, and then he asks, you know, why did you send for me? And then Cornelius explains, this is what happened to me. I was in prayer, and I had this, you know, message from this angel, and I was supposed to call you. And he goes on, you know, with all the details. I'm supposed to send people to Simon's house, Simon the Tanner, whose house is by the sea. And I'm sure, you know, Peter's eyes are just growing wide and wide. Wow, this is a God setup. Something's about to happen here, right? It's a big moment, but it starts with obedience. It starts with hearing the voice of God. It starts with a small conversation. He goes so Cornelius, shares everything, and then he goes and he sees all these people. Then Peter begins to share. He says, I perceive that God shows no partiality. I perceive that God shows no partiality. You know, I'm sure that the Holy Spirit would have quickened the words of the Lord Jesus when he spoke to Nicodemus. And when he came by night, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. That whoever, Jew, non-Jew, murderer, someone living a very questionable lifestyle, the woman at the well, woman caught in adultery, whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So he says, I perceive that God shows no partiality, Cornelius. And he begins to share the word. He talks about the word which was sent to the children of Israel, preaching peace and salvation about the kingdom through Jesus. And he says, Jesus is Lord of all. And then he also talks about how God anointed Jesus. This is verse 38, God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. So he was man on earth, God who came in the form of man, and whatever he did by the power of the Holy Spirit, Cornelius, and everyone else. He did it by the power of the Holy Spirit. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. Amen. So Jesus is for us. He is for us, not against us. And he is still doing good today. Amen. And the good includes all the healing and the deliverance and the hope and the comfort and everything that he did in the past. And the enemy goes about, the devil goes about oppressing and putting people with all kinds of prisons and hopeless situations. But the Lord has come to give us hope, to give us life in all its fullness. So he's just sharing that, declaring that. He talks about the death and the resurrection of the Lord. He says, we are witnesses to all these things. We are witnesses, Cornelius. We are witnesses, friends and family of Cornelius. We are witnesses. We've seen this. He died and he rose again. He died and he rose again, and God showed him openly to all of us as witnesses. We saw. He even ate and drank with us. After he was raised up, we had, you know, lunch with him. We had dinner with him. He ate and drank with us. He spoke to us. He taught us. And then he says that he commanded us to preach and testify. And dear church, says, to him all the prophets, whatever we read in the past, they all witness and they testify and they say that whoever believes in him will receive remission of sins. Whoever believes in him. So he's just preaching that. And whoever believes in him. Now, you know, as people who maybe grew up in church, and maybe, you know, we've accepted the Lord many years ago, this thing of remission, of forgiveness of sin, you know, it's a common talk. Like, we hear about it, we sing about it, and it's a regular feature. And maybe sometimes we take it for granted. But this remission, removal of sin, is something that only Jesus can do. Amen. And it's like a big weight. It's a big burden. And the world is waiting for that, to be unburdened. This removal of sin, you know, it doesn't come from self-help books or self-development, you know, seminars or any kind of New Age thing. It does not come. This remission of sins is only in the name of Jesus. It's only through the person of Jesus. So it's a unique thing. And that is why the Lord Jesus said, you know, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. It's a big thing. No one else can take away that burden. And that's why Paul himself says, you know, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for salvation. It is the power of God. It requires the power of God to break the power of sin and bring salvation into our lives. So it's a big thing. So he says, this remission of sin. And praise God, you know, for those of us who have experienced it, and those of us who are yet to experience it. And he's saying, you know, if you're sitting here and thinking, and, you know, I'm at that place, you know, maybe I have this all this knowledge and understanding in my mind, but in my heart, there's no experience. Like Saul. You know, I know the words, I know the books, I've been trained, but in my heart, there's no experience. Now, I just like to share, you know, this happened many years ago in the church where I worshipped, you know, in my hometown. And there was a evangelistic meeting, and there was a worship leader, actually. He came and he did some meetings there, and a wonderful time of worship. But in one of the meetings, he shared the gospel. Right? In one of the meetings, he shared the gospel. And he gave an altar call. Now, you must understand that this doesn't happen very often in some of the churches, right? At least in the churches where I grew up, it doesn't happen often. There's no altar call and, you know, salvation message and all. It's maybe 2-3 times a year, I can count. But this person who came, he shared, he gave the altar call. And the first person to accept the Lord was the pastor of the church. Traditional church, first person to accept. He had all the learnings. He's gone through seminary. But he saw that day, hey, this is something very different. This is something which is real. And Paul talks about that. You know, when one turns to the Lord, that veil upon our heart is removed. He's talking about, you know, even today when Moses is read, there is a veil. They're reading it. Well, it's about Jesus, but there's a veil. But that veil is removed when one turns to Jesus. And this pastor, he knew the whole congregation was there. He didn't care. He didn't care. He said, I want Jesus. In him, his life. Only in him is remission of sin. We could be burdened heavily by sin and the outworking of sin. bitterness and strife and hatred and all that, and you know, or just the fact that there is emptiness. But Jesus, He removes. In Him there is remission of sin. So if you're seated here and you've been thinking and debating and, hey, do I need Jesus? Do I, you know, what do I do? Well, there is remission of sin. Only in Jesus. And it's not difficult. It's by grace. We don't earn it. We just receive it by faith. With gratitude, we receive it. Amen. So even as we are, you know, even as you're here, just receive Jesus. Just say, Jesus, come into my heart. I receive you. Remove this burden of sin I've been carrying all my life. Come, cleanse me. I want to be your child. And something else happens. Even as Peter's speaking, obviously the congregation and Cornelius, their hearts were so warmed and they saw the truth for what it is. And obviously they received Jesus even as he was speaking, even as Peter was sharing. And they began to praise the Lord, magnify God, give thanks to God, because the Holy Spirit filled them up and they began to pray in other tongues. They began praying in tongues. Now, Peter and other Jews who were with him, they were astonished. They heard them speak with tongues, magnify God. And it says, you know, the first reaction, some of the reactions that the people had when they heard Peter pray in tongues, the same reaction they were having. You know, you see, some of them were astonished, they were amazed, they were perplexed, right? Some of them made fun, but here they were astonished, Peter and the other Jews, they were astonished because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on them, on the Gentiles, as it was poured out on them also. So, Peter, obviously there's a lot of celebration. We can just use your imagination. There's a lot happening there. Cornelius, I'm sure he's just bouncing off the walls. You know, he's planned this, he's waited for many days, and here it is, friends, relatives, experiencing Jesus, experiencing the power of the Holy Spirit, praying out in tongues, and I'm sure there was laughter, there were tears, all kinds of emotions. And Peter says, hey, how can I stop them from being baptized in water? And then he gets them all baptized in water, in the name of the Lord. And they asked him to stay there for a few days. And that's how chapter 10 ends, on a very celebratory note. There's a lot of celebration. There's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of joy. You know, if you read chapter 8, we see that in Samaria, there was a lot of joy because strongholds were broken, weights were taken off. And I'm sure somebody started singing in tongues. You know, somebody started singing out there and maybe somebody's running around. Hey, I'm healed. You know, all that. I can see, or I can move my hand, and all that is happening. And there's even greater rejoicing that is happening in the heavens, because the Lord Jesus said, when there's one sinner who turns, you know, I just want to invite the worship team, come up. When there's one sinner who turns, there's great rejoicing in the heavens. Amen. Amen. You know, so today, it's a moment that you can decide, if you have not, you know, those of you who are watching online and, you know, seated here, the joy of the Lord, you know, we sang, declared, there's joy and there's inexpressible joy amidst difficulties, amidst everything, the storms of life. There's the joy of the Lord that the world cannot give and no one can take away from you. It's yours. And that joy comes with Jesus. And He wants to release that in our lives. He wants to turn our mourning into dancing, extreme sorrow into extreme joy. The Lord wants to do that in our lives, if you would open your heart to Him. Amen. And this is also a time where we can pray for maybe, you know, the leaders of our nation, maybe people in our own families who are yet to experience Jesus. We know that Jesus is not about a religion. We know it's not about joining a church. We know it's none of that. But it's life. It's a change in destiny. So if there are people in our own homes, maybe it's a spouse, maybe it's a, you know, maybe children, and they need to experience Jesus, we can lift them up today and say, God, won't you visit them in sovereign ways, in ways they understand, God, in their context? You know, would you meet with them sovereignly? Angelic visitation. Powerful times, just like Saul had, God, would you visit them? And we can also pray and say, Lord, use us to facilitate an encounter like Cornelius. We want to invite our friends and family and open up the house. And God, we want to be in expectation because, God, you move, you speak, God. And you change their lives. And you know, great things can start with a conversation. You know, we know that tagline, you know, a lot can happen over coffee, right? A lot can happen with a conversation. I remember, you know, bunking college and going to this friend's house. And we were just sitting there and we just wanted to chat. We were just tired of classes. And so we bunked and we bent and sat and we were just talking about, you know, life. And I just told him, by then I had accepted the Lord. I told him, hey, this is what happened in whatever way I could. And so he was listening and then he said, yeah, I know. I'm not in that place yet. But I'm interested, I'm willing, and I think, let's see, I don't know whether we prayed, but it was a little awkward, you know, first time, both of us, you know, we've been drinking buddies, and we're just sitting and talking about this, seemed very awkward and different, but he just went with it. And many years later, I hear that he has accepted the Lord, he and his family, he's a leader in one of the churches, you know, overseas, and one of the elders there and wants to serve the Lord. Another friend, his name is Govind. He went to his house for Onam, and I remember him being, he's getting ready to go to some of the mountains to pray and worship. And so he was dressed in, you know, that attire, and he's grown his beard and, you know, wearing all the beads and everything. And so he would make fun. He'd say, hey, Jakes, you need to get back to drinking. You need to get back. What is this? You know, feeling all left out, and they were not pleased at all. But I don't know whether I really shared, but I think, you know, he just made fun of whatever I could say and do. He just made fun. But years later, I hear, and I was really astounded when I heard that he had become a believer. When I heard that he was a pastor, you know, he was a pastor ministering to a Filipino community at that time, and he's in another place, but he's pastoring. Praise God. The Lord is waiting for you and I. Because there's a lot on the line, right? The destinies of people, it's on the line. The Lord is really looking for obedient hearts. We'll say, with all my fear, with all my awkwardness, social awkwardness, and social anxiety and all that, God, if you will use me, here I am, you know. And the Lord will. The Lord will. So let's pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you that you're God who saves. You make impossible things possible. Lord, things that we think are impossible, God. Things that go beyond our imagination. You are able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think or imagine today. Lord, we invite you. You know, go ahead. invite Jesus if you've never ever done before. Maybe you've been a religious person, going to church. You can invite Jesus into your heart and say, Jesus, come into my heart. You know, he's a gentleman. He doesn't force his way in. But the Bible says he stands at the door and knocks. And if we would open our heart, the door of our heart, and say, Jesus, come into my heart, he will. He says, I will come and I will fellowship. And I just want to tell you that there's no one like Jesus. He's beautiful. He's amazing. There's no one like Jesus. So you can pray something like this. Lord Jesus, I need you. There is remission of sin only in your name. So I need you. So come into my heart. Come into my life. Change me from the inside out. I want to be your child. I believe that you died for me. I believe that you rose again for me. Come into my heart. And if, you know, if there's anyone here and you pray that prayer for the first time, you know, can you just put your hand up? We just want to pray with you. You prayed that prayer, maybe online. If you prayed that prayer also, you can put your hand up. Anyone, you know, if you prayed that prayer for the first time saying, I invited Jesus, you know, with a religious person maybe, but I invite anyone, anyone? For the first time, you invited Jesus into your heart. For the first time, you prayed that prayer. Okay. You don't see any hands. But if you have any questions, you know, if you want to talk about it, we are here. If you have questions, maybe you want to pray, someone to pray for you, and willing to do that, you can stay back. And let's just invite Jesus. Invite his presence and power. And would you like to stand up, please? And say, Lord, yeah, sovereign visitations, angelic visitations, God, have your way. Rule, reign, reign in our hearts, reign in our homes, reign over us, God. Reign over us, God. Fill us to overflowing. Use us. I surrender, I yield, God. My life is not my own, but it's yours because you purchased. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again? Yes, Lord. I give you my life. I give you my all. And I say, come. Be enthroned in my heart. Be enthroned in my life. Oh, you are the light. Oh, of all I am. Oh, God. So won't you reign in me? Oh, yes, Lord. God of heaven and earth, come reign in us, God. Your power and over all my dreams, and in my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. Oh God, so won't you reign in me again? Oh, reign in me, reign in your power. Yes, God. Dreams in my darkest hour, you are the Lord. All I am, just invite it to rule, invite it to reign over all the earth. You reign on high, and every mountain stream. And every sunset sky. But my one request, Lord, my only aim,
is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power.
Just invite the Lord to pour out his spirit and say, Lord, I need a fresh infilling. Baptize me with your spirit, God. Fill me with your power. Lord, release the gifts of the spirit in me.
Oh, won't you reign?
Let's just get desperate for God.
Oh, God, Lord, reign in me. Reign in your power over all my dreams and in my darkest hour. You are my Lord.
Yes, God.
Yes, oh, God, so won't you reign in me?
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, we ask you, we invite you, oh God, to reign in us, God. Order our steps, God. Ordain the steps that we need to take, the path, establish it, God. May we be a people, may we be a church, oh God, that walks in righteousness, that walks in your ways. Lord, may we be a church, may we be a people, Lord, who are sensitive, Lord, to your voice. And not just sensitive, but Lord, who are obedient to your voice, God. And Lord, we pray and ask, oh God, for divine orchestration, divine appointments, God. Lord, for our loved ones, God. Lord, for the leaders of our state and our nation, Lord. Lord, we pray, oh God, for a release, oh Father God, of divine appointments, oh God. Yes, Master. Lord, we ask, oh God, let there be sovereign visitations, dreams, visions, God, supernatural encounters, God, angelic visitations, Father God. And Lord, we pray, God. Yes, Master. Just like Saul. Just like how it's happened to Saul. Let hearts be changed. Let lives be changed, God. And today, God, we pray and we ask, oh God, use us to facilitate divine encounters. Even as we open up our hearts and lives and homes and, God, conversations, seemingly innocent conversations leading to big decisions and big choices, changing of destinies. Use us in these ways, God. Have your way, God. Have your way, God. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. You know, even as we ask the Lord to reign over us, even as he reigns, darkness has to flee. You know, there can't be two people on the throne. So God, well established in our throne, when we invite him, he's enthroned. And everything else, strongholds have to come down. You know, good works are released as he reigns because he is the king. Righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Spirit. That is what he releases. So can we just pray and ask the Lord, Lord, you reign, even as you reign, let every work of darkness, let it be repelled. I want to partner with you, God. I don't want to partner with the works of the enemy. Let there be a new life. Let there be change, God. Let there be the pattern of working, of pattern of cycle of sin and defeat. Let it be broken in the mighty name of Jesus. Reign in me, God. Reign in us, God. Hallelujah. 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 Yes, Lord, we pray, oh God, let sick bodies be made whole in Jesus' name. You know, just receive it. Just say, Lord, I receive you, the healer. I receive you, my shalom. I receive you, my breakthrough. I receive you, my provision. Come, Lord, change, rearrange. Yes, Lord, let there be release, oh God. Healing and provision and breakthroughs, God. Yes, Lord, long, stubborn symptoms in the mighty name of Jesus, we declare, even as our body is yielded to Jesus, you have no place, no right. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord, let there be a clearing of minds, oppressive thoughts. You will leave in Jesus' name. Whatever is causing that, you will leave in Jesus' name. And we close all those doorways in the mighty name of Jesus. Bless you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father God. We give you all the praise at this time. And we give you all the glory. Reign in us. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us, remain with us today and in the great adventure that's ahead of us. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.
Thank you for listening. We trust this message was a blessing to you. For more free resources, including sermons, sermon notes, and books, please visit apcwo.org. For information on APC Bible College in Bangalore, visit apcbiblecollege.org. Do remember to download the All People's Church Bangalore app from the Apple or Google Play Store.